Just get out of here. Ugh. All right. So we'll tweet out that we're live. Live now. Recording another action-packed episode.
Yeah, we're live as shit.
Weird things. At. DiamondClub.tv. Boom. All right. You ready to go? Because I'm ready to go.
Hell yeah.
All right. I'll count you in. We go 5, 4, 3, 2.
Can you hear that sound, guys? Everybody? Everybody listening? That's a sound of soaring expectations going through distant space. My fellow travelers, Justin Robert Young.
Hi, I'm here.
My co-pilot on the other side, Brian Brushwood.
I mean, I'm physically here, but my heart is in the cold, heartless vacuum of space.
That's right, gentlemen. But you know what? We won't have to suffocate and die immediately. And you're both drinking at the same time, which is a challenge for me as soon as they both take drinks to
we
call
We figured
it.
Out we could both turn the nuke keys at the same time and then
exactly.
short-circuits it.
So... what for do I speak of? Well, if you didn't hear the news, maybe you did, but we'll just recap it for you. Anyways, this week, NASA launched the Orion spacecraft on top of a Delta IV heavy rocket. What is the Orion? Orion is man's reentry to distant space, not just Earth orbit, which is pretty awesome. LEO, there's a lot going on there, okay? International Space Station, we've got the Dragon capsule going there, but now... for the first time, we've tested a new space flight system for putting man into space, and it could go since the space shuttle, right? Now, the Dragon capsule, when the crew-rated version's ready, in theory, you could put people on board the one they have now, but it's not. It's the one they're building, the one that Elon Musk unveiled, is still yet to come and do its test. But Orion right now is the next step. What this can do, what this spacecraft can do, it can hold 7 people, right, which is cool. 7 people, a lot of people. Like, I don't have 7 good friends I'd bring you guys.
It's like if you had 6 invites, you'd have to, like, save the last 2 for Willy Wonka golden tickets is the only way you'd fill those seats.
Yeah, I'd have you. I'd have Justin. Maybe Tom and Veronica.
Yeah, all right. Sure. That's 5.
Maybe Amtrekker.
Yeah, okay, yeah. You're up to 6.
Yeah.
And I guess the rest will just fill with snacks, right? Take a big old bag of potato chips.
Yes, Sour Patch Kids. You know, maybe a Malamar.
Some beef jerky.
I think we, you know, give it up to a Weird Things listener, you know.
Right on.
Or that. Yeah, sure.
But fill their pockets full of snacks. So, 7 people can fit on board this Orion spacecraft. But what's really cool is that it's not just for going around the Earth. This thing could go orbit around the moon, right? And it's not just a matter of, well, what's the difference? Well, coming back from the moon, to go to the moon, you got to go fast. And coming back from the moon, you're coming in really, really fast. So that's going to be one of the later tests. What they did on Friday, they launched this thing up, orbited the Earth twice, and splashed down in the Pacific Ocean.
Man.
Now, you can see a picture of a drop test if you're watching live where they shoved it out of the back of a cargo plane.
You know, that's the thing is underneath that astonishingly huge rocket, it looks like the tiniest little pin top of a cap. But when you look at it being dropped from the back of a freighter plane, I mean, this thing's a giant RV size, 2 RVs.
Yeah, it's big. So, like, if we want to go to Mars, you know, we need a capsule. We need something to get people up into space and back. You wouldn't be spending the whole trip to Mars inside of this thing.
No.
You would spend that trip, you know, there'd be another capsule. There'd be another, you know, pressurized, you know, area for you. But this is the platform that they want to start building, you know, man's continuing exploration of space. After this, what they're working on next is a rocket booster called the SLS. And a little controversial, but we'll get into the science of it. The SLS will be the most powerful booster since the Saturn, and I think even more so than the Saturn. And what's cool about the SLS is it's – to give an example of why they want this rocket is when we sent probes like the Pioneer probes out past the solar system, it took like, you know, out past the sun's heliosphere, it took 30 years to get there. The SLS, bigger, faster, brawnier, it'll get there in 10 years if you send a probe.
Wow. Now, that's significant because I remember, you know, the Voyager trip took forever. It was like, they're like, holy crap, that thing still works. And we're getting, you know, is it safe to say that the Voyager is the most successful exploration space, unmanned space exploration in the history of astronomy?
I certainly think it gave us a ton of data. But then if you start looking at what Hubble gave us to...
You're right. Hubble gives us a direct view on a lot of that stuff. Good point. I stand corrected, sir.
But Voyager was a, you know, Voyager for what that mission gave us and what it did as far as, you know, first view of, you know, flyby of Jupiter, you know, seeing what's going on there, you know, just exploring this, the whole, you know, incredible, incredible amount of data. So, I mean, it's... They're all special to me.
Fair enough. But at any rate, the reason, of course, we're talking about it is if you listen to last week's episode, we dropped a little knowledge bomb that one of us would be live on the scene. And apparently in, was it the New York Times as well?
Yeah. So there's a program that NASA has, and I encourage everybody to follow right now. Listen, it's at NASA Social on Twitter, okay? As well as you should be following at NASA. Now, if you follow at NASA Social, every now and then they have these meetups where they invite people who are involved in social media. Now, you don't have to be like a science journalist. You don't have to have like a podcast like Weird Things. Maybe you're a person that just likes to take photographs. Maybe you're active on Instagram. Maybe you're a school teacher with a classroom full of kids and you're a bit active and you like to talk about these things. Go sign up for at NASA Social. And the next time they have one of these things, apply. Now, you have to pay your own airfare, your own expenses and all that, but this is what's really cool, is that you get a behind-the-scenes tour of NASA. You get, you know, you get your own NASA Social credentials so you can go see what goes on, you know, the way NASA functions. You get to talk to people involved with the mission. You know, we met with a bunch of astronauts. We got to go all around, take a tour of the Kennedy Space Center. We went into the vehicle, the VAB, the Vehicle Assembly Building, the big, huge building where they put stuff together. We talked to people who are working on SLS. We talked to the people who are the, you know, the director of the Orion program. We actually, Holden, the director of NASA came and addressed us. Elmo was even there.
That's insane.
All right, Elmo, we went to the Kennedy Visitor Complex and watched a presentation, and then Elmo came out and, you know, talked about how excited he was. So it's really, really, and it's a fantastic program. Last week, Fast Company's Sue Carlin, who actually we have a story we'll be using for a topic today, she did a whole overview of the NASA Social program. They're doing a great job of reaching out to people. So I encourage all of you, sign up for at NASA Social and maybe tweet at NASA Social, you know, on Twitter. Say, hey, Weird Things told me to, you know, sign up.
Right on. And so how far in advance do you have to do it?
This is really remarkable in what this moment that has excited us about space travel. NASA really seems to be taking the bull by the horns and kind of fanning the flames of people just being really jacked about what's happening in space exploration.
Well, and I think it's a smart move on their part, because for a long time, you know, NASA's biggest heyday was at the height of the Cold War, when everyone had space fever, and it was already on the lips of everyone what, you know, they wanted to see NASA doing next. But, you know, in an age where where we're not racing in a wiener measuring contest with any other big superpower, it's you got to make a
case. Not saying any names.
I'm just saying that that it's smart for them to make a case and keep themselves relevant on the public's mind. PR becomes more and more important as they need to keep their funding.
And I'm going to tell you a couple things here, which you know, going behind the scenes, I mean, I drank that Kool-Aid and I'm just gulping it down right now. Okay.
Yeah.
You could see how excited people at NASA were about this program, and justifiably so. We talked to astronauts who, after the think about this, you're all your life, you want to be an astronaut. And then you're in the program, you work hard because this is the one focus you have. You get to NASA and the space shuttle program is
over,
winded down.
Yeah,
now, we will go on about how excited we are about SpaceX. And next week, guess what, folks? It's going to be SpaceX. But right now I'm going to talk about what's going on the Orion. Now you're an astronaut. What you got to see Friday was you got to see a capsule that you perfectly could have sat inside of there and had a nice trip around the world. It's back. NASA's back in the mission, back in the job of putting people on space. They talk about Orion being flexible, seeing that, you know, being that it could be, they launched this on top of a Delta. They want to put it on top of the SLS. Maybe it could fit on top of a Falcon. Who knows? But anyhow, they've got this Orion, you know, now we have a spacecraft capable of taking people back into space, right? I watched it. We saw it. We saw it there live. We saw this thing go up. Next up is they want to build the SLS, which would be this big, huge rocket system. And what's exciting about that is if you're a scientist and a researcher, we talked about before, if you wanted to get something to the outer edges of the solar system for research, and it takes 30 years to do that, you have to teach your graduate students to follow through on that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Versus now, if you can look at a 10-year time span, that's a lot more relevant, much faster. So it's exciting. It's a very, very, very exciting period right now for NASA, for space enthusiasts. We've got these programs, and you know, the big focus was a mission to Mars. A big, you know, and I think that that's a big focus on the idea of trying to get to Mars. We don't have an official Mars program. We have a timeline, and we have things we're developing for that. But you know, NASA wants to do like a lunar orbit. They want to do an asteroid capture recovery, which, you know, there's been a measured, you know, different sort of reactions to whether or not that's a worthwhile goal or not. I think anytime we're putting people in a space and figuring out how to get them to live out there is great.
So we talked about a lot of this. We did a live special, and thanks to all of you guys who tuned in at diamondclub.tv at the, oh my God, early hour of 4:30 in the morning Pacific time. And all over the world, it was cool to have everybody be there live. It took two attempts, right? 2 days you went in. The first time, we kept filling a lot of air because there was a boat hanging around too close.
Yeah, there were. Yeah, that may have been the range. So for this mission, what it has to do, it had to go around the Earth twice and then land in the Pacific. So there is, because of that, the launch window was like a 2.5 hour launch window, which just means the time they can launch. And that was based kind of mainly on resources, where you have a crew out in the Pacific that has a boat that's supposed to capture this and helicopters and stuff like that. And you can't keep them out there forever. So after a certain number of length, you have to have everybody go back in and say, let's do it the next day. So the upside was that they could do it the next day at the same period and do that. First day, it was just delay after delay after delay. And you're kind of like, well, you know, do I come back tomorrow? Because they said it was only a 40% chance of launch. You know, there's a debating that. But the cool thing about a reason you to consider applying for NASA Social is that one of the best parts about it was the people I got to hang out with. I made a lot of great friends, had a lot of great friends there. You're out there with everybody has this common purpose. You know, people from all walks of life. And I met a lot of great, you know, interesting people. You know, I would start naming people, forget names and stuff. But I met a guy named Cole, who's an amazing programmer, does photography. Is Cole Rise is his Instagram. He's got like 100,000 followers and stuff. You know, I met a girl named Rhiannon, who's a home shopping network model, who's active in social media, who we had on our live stream. We had a Space Girl M. We had Emily, who was a, you know, very, very active. She's got a television show. I think the Universe Today.
I believe it's Exploration Outer Space. It's on Hulu that you can watch, and it's targeted towards family audiences. It's Emily Calandarelli. It's MCal Space Gal was her Twitter. She was very cool to talk to.
Yeah, listen here, folks. You know, that was 2.5 hours of a rocket not getting launched, which, you know, was not great if you were there to watch a rocket get launched. But it was a pretty fun 2.5 hours for us to hang out and talk space with a bunch of really rad people, which speaks to, you know, what a fun experience it was just to hang out with like-minded individuals who are just really, really excited about what was going on.
Joey the Rocket Guy, who's like knew more about everything that was going on with the launch than I could even imagine. This guy's a super, super space nut, you know, was relaying to us all the facts and details about what was going on, timeframes, things like that. There was a woman, Rebecca, a school teacher from Minnesota, was there. Really cool. She knew about all the different missions and stuff. It was just an amazing group of people to be around there. And I want to encourage everybody listening, if you're active in social media in some way, I encourage you to try. And maybe if you don't have a bunch of Twitter followers, but you blog or you do other things where you can get it. You know, NASA wants people who can reach out to people in other ways. So go for it.
Yeah, it was kind of like a party for the rocket, whether the rocket decided to play shy that day or not. it was really cool.
And then it went flawless the day after. You know, if you are, and I think we're going to put this up for the patrons, our special that we did. It's effectively one thing because we did 2.5 hours the first day when it didn't get launched, and there was barely a stream the next next.
It went
morning.
Off right on time the next day.
Yeah.
Brian held it down for the 5 minutes that apparently took the rocket. You guys know I am a fan of hyperbole and putting the big exclamation point on it.
You're the world's biggest fan of hyperbole.
Biggest fan of hyperbole. Is this the most meaningful step towards Mars in human history?
Up to this point?
Up to this point.
I mean, it's the most significant tested thing. I think the plans for SpaceX are even more so. You know, obviously, if 5 years from now we have a completely reusable 3-stage rocket, that's going to be the biggest thing to get us to Mars.
Hmm. I cannot go over again how valuable the experience was. And I think that what I would love to, and there was also, you know, they're only able to invite a certain number of people to go participate in this because this particular launch was so big. There was a group of people who wanted to go but couldn't get in, and they formed their own group called Rogue Social.
Oh, that's great.
And so we went after going to the launch, you know, waiting for launch, you know, we 2 days in a row, we met up at some restaurant, whatever, and there were, you know, 100 people there. It was great. It was just this excitement. And these are people who organized themselves, you know, as they used hashtag Rogue Social. I want to give a shout out to everybody in Rogue Social for just, you know, they're like, well, if we can't get in, we're still going to be there. We still want to be participating. And the best part of it, you know, aside from getting access is awesome, but you know, the best part was the people you get to meet. You get to see other people who feel as excited about this as you are. When this thing launched, people are crying, and it's hard, you know, because you try to explain this to other people, and they go, "Oh, okay, that's cool." And it's like, yeah, but when you're there, and I'm all for the idea that, like, you know, we really encourage. We have 15,000 listeners to this podcast, and I think that I would love for us to find out how many people are interested in going to these things, because we can do our own events. You know, we've covered stuff. We've done little meetups before it launches. We could organize our own stuff. You know, maybe we can be there, maybe we're not, but let's get SpaceX, or excuse me, let's get Weird Things fans, Freudian slip. let's get fans there to let's get the Weird Things fans and say, hey, let's meet up to do that.
Okay, well, here I don't want to circle back here too far, but just to go back to my question before, you know, and I see Ken from Chicago is here in the chat room and echoing Brian's sentiment that, you know, SpaceX could take us to Mars without NASA, and I understand that, and we have done however many episodes of this podcast to establish all of our credentials on how big hardcore SpaceX fans we are, but if we are talking about humankind, and this is the first thing that has happened chronologically, then you would have to say that this is the most meaningful step toward Mars that we have had as humanity, right?
I guess yes, as far as actual things. I mean, but that's tough. It's certainly the latest step, but, you know, wouldn't you make a case that the biggest first step was getting out of gravity or achieving orbit
what I'm looking for. Unless I'm missing something. I mean, I guess that's my question is that, like, it is, I mean, everything takes steps. Is this a further step? Not necessarily drawing it on government versus private company lines,
let me clarify it this way. I think this is a really good test of the will of the people in the government. What SpaceX has done and what Elon Musk has done has shown the will of an incredibly, extremely rare, brilliant guy who, you know, we just don't have enough of, and how far he could take that, how far he could take something and inspire everybody else and create incredible technologies. Now we're seeing, hey, guess what? You know, our country wants to make this thing happen. People want to make this happen. Scientists, researchers want to make this thing happen. And so it's you know, it's showing that there is a will there beyond people like us or just a sort of a smaller group. And it's all important. And you know, we don't need to, you know, figure out where we step things on the Olympic trophy stand here. It comes down to, I'm encouraged because of what's happening, you know, tapping at Orion, and we'll get into next week why I think that's the most important launch perhaps since, you know, Yuri Gagarin, you know?
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what's cool. One of the things we did was there was a meetup we went to, and it was for Yuri, and it was like it was a fundraiser because there's an organization that celebrates Yuri Gagarin and what he achieved, you know? And I love the idea that these things, you certainly want to do a little bit of flag waving, you know, of it, but at the end, it's about human achievement. You know, this Orion and, you know, the craft and NASA is built by people from around the world. It's the contributions of the planet Earth. And you want to celebrate these achievements regardless of, you know, jingoism or what have you. And I'm going to throw this as a quick aside too. I forgot to address this was, I'll tell you what made this so special though, is I went to the launch, met some great people. I hung out with Cole, hung up with Rhiannon, and rocket goes off. Everybody's happy. We're really excited. A buddy of mine who worked for Disney got us over into Disney. So we went and we did like a Disney tour. You know, we got to go. We hung out at Disney. So we watched a rocket in the morning, spent the whole day at Epcot. We went on Mission to Mars, went to Epcot. We went to Animal Kingdom. We did Hollywood Studios, had a blast. Went out to eat at the German restaurant at Epcot that night. And we're all like, best day ever. Everybody's like, best day ever. Best day ever. And these are like my new friends. Like, you know, it was like, best day ever. Best day ever. The next day, I get a text message from Joe the Rocket Guy. It says, check this out. Front page science section, New York Times, was from an AP photographer shooting for the Houston Chronicle. Well, there it is in the New York Times. There's me standing next to Joe the Rocket Guy, Rhiannon and Cole watching the rocket. It's like, there's like our best day ever, then got immortalized in the New York Times.
That's amazing.
And that is you on the phone with Brian doing the 5-minute day 2 live stream where they totally nailed, you know, taking this.
Yeah, you can see in his right hand, he's holding the phone, talking to me live. Yep. In his left hand, he is taking a 360 degree panoramic video of the takeoff. How awesome, man. I'm just so thrilled that it worked out so well.
Yeah, Cole shot an amazing iPhone video, used a 6 Plus and got a wonderful video of the launch. And I'll try to see if I can find another link for that, where you get the launch and then you get this flock of birds that majestically flies by.
That's great.
That's great.
Well, hey, while you're looking for that, now's as good a time as any to remind people that you can see the entire special. We're going to send it out to all of our patrons, those of you guys who keep us afloat at patreon.com/weirdthings.
We'll make it available eventually to everybody else too.
Of course. Yeah, no, that's that, but yeah, yeah. But you'll get the access earlier on that.
Special
we want membership to have its privileges, because
yes,
we got
yes.
341 of you guys chipping in to help keep this possible. We continue to rise towards our goal of $1,000 a week. We'll guarantee that we're able to keep doing this forever and ever and ever for you guys. Right now, we're happy that we have a better track record than we did before.
Yeah. So we'll wait for, you know, people who listen on the podcast, you know, if this is, you know, your call to action and you really want to be part of it and you want to make sure that you get this ASAP, then we'll wait maybe about 12 hours after we release the podcast so people can listen to it, and then we'll put it out on the Patreon.
Speaking of which, we got, I guess, and this maybe could be our next segment to talk about, we have to a little administrative dispersal of official Weird Things funds. because we decided, we originally put the call out, like, who out there wants to build us this rover so we can actually fund undersea expeditions. But then since we last talked about it, Andrew, you found out that we could skip that entire part and just go straight to a fully created model, right?
Yeah, so I went ahead and I read the webpage. So last episode.
Always a good step is to read what we are going to spend money on as opposed to just taking a cursory look at it, then musing wildly about what we plan to do.
So our tentative project right now is we were talking about doing an underwater robot project. And what we want to do is we're while talking about the idea of undersea exploration, we came across a project called Open ROV, which we're leaning towards. I did send them an email a week ago, no response yet, which doesn't bode well for...
Open ROV, what the holy hey?
You better get my only thing is like, when we want to buy something from you, I have a question, and after a week you don't get a response. We might be open to other open robot projects. I'm just saying that.
I mean, I don't blame you, but I am that guy who constantly means to respond to emails, but just gets...
Oh, I'm super slow, too. I'm super slow, too. But it's when it's like, hey, we have money. We want to give this money to you.
No,
you just have a question
no
for
one's it. Closing any doors. We're just saying that just if saying. You're listening to this right now and you would like to tweet OpenROV and say, please respond to Andrew Main's email, that might speed things along.
So we looked at it, and for $900, we can go and buy the kit. And we had somebody who's volunteered to put this together. We're open to other. We'll take bids for free labor to build this. We can get a fully assembled one. So for the kit is $900. The fully assembled one is $1,450. So for $550 extra. And right now, I mean, you know, we're Justin, Brian, and I plan on just splitting this, you know, three ways and paying it out of our own pockets just to get this thing rolling.
Right.
We might just go ahead and say, hey, you know, we'll get the fully assembled one. And that we not have to worry about.
What, folks? We're doing this for you, okay? We're trying to get this sucker in the water, finding whatever we're going to find in those murky deeps that much quicker. We don't need to go ahead and build it. We can get it fully formed, mail it to one of your houses, and then you can take it out in the back of a pickup truck and drop it in some lake. This is going to be great.
So this is what we need right now. This is what I will throw this out there. We want, for this project, we want an underwater mission manager.
I want it. All right.
Our deep sea explorations manager. And what this is somebody that we can task with basically make you do all the hard work.
Yes.
Boy, you know how to sell it.
Yeah. And what I mean by that is we'll pay for this thing, and then we want people to suggest missions for this thing, and we want somebody to be responsible for it. So
be the point man.
Yeah, point man. So maybe like somebody's like, hey, guess what? In Saskatchewan, we got a monster in the water.
Yep.
You know what? Somebody else is like, hey, I dropped my keys in the outdoor toilet, and it's haunted. Can I use this thing? You need to decide which one you're going to let them use.
Equally valid. Both of those. Equally valid.
Yeah. We want somebody who's going to be maybe like handle, I don't know, shipping this thing off to other people, making sure we get it back. We'll cover the shipping costs. It's not going to cost you money out of that. It'll cost your time.
Okay, look. You got to sexy this up, Andrew. If we're going to get somebody to donate their time for free, then we need to declare them the official Undersecretary of Marine Affairs for the Weird Things podcast. The official Weird Things Admiral.
Yeah, I agree. Totally got to go scale it up.
Admiral, you get to be the
Deep Sea Admiral.
The what's that?
The Deep Sea Admiral.
There you go. The Deep Sea Admiral for the WTP.
Because I'm envisioning, you know, we've talked about doing some balloon stuff, so I'm thinking like we'll have a stratospheric admiral.
Okay. No, that's good for our air fleet. No,
this thing we can't talk about the near space admiral, and then that other thing, the deep space admiral, which we'll get into later.
Yeah. Dude, yes, so you can apply for that position if you'd like.
Mm-hmm.
There's a running theme in this podcast. We are just looking for like-minded people to do epic stuff.
Dude,
what this episode is all about. Andrew did it with NASA Social. Out there having a great time watching history get made. We are asking you, the listener, if for whatever reason the spark is in your head that you want to help explore the world around you, we need your help because we are going to supply the means to do it.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And if let's say you're a school teacher. Hey, you want to use this for a project with your students. Maybe you're a parent. You have two kids. And like, hey, can we use it for a few days to go somewhere and go do that? We're totally, totally open to that.
You know what?
We just need somebody to be a responsible adult, which is not us, to just sort of, you know, maybe be the admiral, the harbor master, whatever of this. I have a friend in South Florida who's got a really good, you know, gifted class of kids that are really eager into projects, building robots and stuff. I haven't told him about this. If I told him, said, hey, we have this. Do you guys want to use it? I'm sure he'd be all over it.
So. You could just start signing all of your legal documents, Admiral Brian Brushwood, comma, WTP. And it'll be an official designation.
And so where would they, Justin, do you, can we use your email address for this again?
Yeah, come on in to justinrobertyoung@gmail.com. Write weird things in the subject line so I can keep a good handle on it, and we will go from there.
Right on.
Real quick, if you are in Los Angeles this Saturday, there is a virtual reality LA meetup. If you go to meetup and type in VR LA, you can get the details on that. Justin and I went to one before, which is a really cool experience. You get an get a view of what this whole virtual reality thing is all about.
Yeah, this thing was super, super awesome. And if you want a chance to see where virtual reality is now and where it's going, both of which for me was surprising, A, how far it was, and B, where it realistically can be in the very near future, you should head out. It was well worth it. And, man, get your tickets now and come early, because that thing was a circus last time and it will only get bigger this time.
Speaking of virtual worlds, Sue Carlin, who did a great article about the NASA social program, interviewed me, put up an embed video of our Weird Things podcast where we covered the last launch that we did like 2 years ago, has an article out, and it's about how world building will shape the future of media and business. And it's on Fast Company. And she talks about a conference and curriculum that's being put together on the subject of world building and the idea of, let's just take it beyond just, hey, it's a thing you do in video games, where let's put some trees here and let's do this, and get into the idea of treating it as a whole interdisciplinary study. They had people involved with it. The curriculum is put together by the production designer of Minority Report and Man of Steel named Alex McDowell, who's, very, really, very talented person, although he designed my least favorite interface in Minority Report with the glowing fingers. Other than that, it's great, which I'm sure was necessitated by wanting to have something very cinematic. But they bring people together, and for this project, what they were doing is they had this island, or this archipelago, which is nothing, something I can never pronounce, and they had to design like a whole culture that lived there. And you bring in people from students, educators, scientists, designers, urban planners, and other things I'm reading off of Susan's article, and all coming in to try to design what would this place look like. And this is, we're getting into this point where, if you think about it, one of the reasons I love Disney World is it's a very idealized, it's a cool way where Disney World is, you got to look at Disneyland. Let's take Disneyland. Disneyland was Walt Disney's gateway between our world and this fantasy world that only existed in movies and animated cartoons. Mm-hmm. And then you step into Disneyland and you feel like you're there. There is that castle. There is Cinderella's castle from Cinderella. There are the seven dwarves. There are that. And I think that it's an amazing, it's like you're crossing into another dimension. And you kind of, in a way, are, because you're giving these engineers and scientists and imagineers the ability to say, okay, how can we make our reality look as much like this imaginary reality? And now we have bigger tools to do that with.
So you're not talking about just in a virtual sense, like you get with video games. You mean in a real meat space, and I assume you mean bigger than just the idea of theme parks and those kinds of attractions.
Well, I mean, for this seems to be focused on in computer space in that space of where they're doing it. But the idea is that eventually these things can kind of blend back into our world. But right here, it's like you get a bunch of people together and say, let's create a virtual world, not a game where you got to do this as a level to do this, but let's create a place and a way it functions and life forms and all this, and follow that through and taking this just outside of the game world and into what else can you learn and understand by that.
That's interesting, because the goal, one of the goals when you're making a game, and I guess this is the distinction that I haven't read the article, and so I'm sort of just making sure I grasp it. When you make a game, you are less interested in the world and more interested in the engagement. They'll look at, as they refine maps, Blizzard and Bungie will look at death heat maps and figure out, are people dying at pretty much throughout the entire map? And then other times they'll watch people play the game and they'll say, you know, there was a 10-minute stretch where they didn't use the crouch button once, which means that they are getting a less diverse experience than they could. So they build something in there to have you solve and combine things to get this novel stuff. All of that is about the gameplay. Now, you can set these in wonderful cinematic visceral worlds that are places you wish you could go, but oftentimes that's not the primary impetus on this. And so to have the entire focus be on, you know, how you craft these worlds. Like, are they all working to create one world, or?
Yeah, they're collaborating together on one world.
That's amazing. And so it'll be realized similar to like a Second Life thing, I guess, because when you're building a new world from scratch, you have to decide on small things like how much gravity do we want on this world? You know, how hard do you want it to hurt when you fall in this world? How fast can people travel in this world, and why? Because there's this, there's a weird scaling down that happens. You know, I'm playing Far Cry 4 right now a whole bunch, and it's amazing to see how they have a consistent. I would love to have somebody describe for me, like, when it feels like I'm driving fast enough in the game, how much does that translate to in that world speed? Am I doing 30, 35 miles an hour? Am I doing 60? Feels kind of fast, but I don't really have a sense.
Okay, that's a great crossover example where you could say that, like, we realize in this video game it feels faster if you're traveling this way, and that we realize that's because the trees are smaller.
Right, right. Or the camera is intentionally closer to the ground, so you get a sense of speed.
But I'm saying, as an urban planner,
sure,
I can then say, oh, smaller trees. Let's use small trees that go by you. So you're seeing, instead of seeing these big trees go by, a bunch of small trees pass you, and you're judging that, thinking you're going faster. So if I want people to slow down, so I can do something in a virtual space and then learn something there that I can then take back into our space.
That is fascinating stuff. I just finished reading Traffic, which is about all of this stuff, where it's like, I was talking to Justin about it. There are some places where they do the most counterintuitive things to make it safer. They remove all of the signs, all of the lines, and they have cobblestones instead of asphalt, so that you pull up and you don't have the social cues that let your brain switch off and just assume that you're okay to drive in your lane. So instead, all of a sudden, everybody creeps to a crawl and they're hyper-focused as they see pedestrians and bicyclists and everyone going all around. And in the one example he gave, they've not had a single accident since then. But
it's interesting because I know, like, turnabouts, you know, for a while, like in the 90s, that was saying, like, we need to use those more. They put one in Fort Lauderdale and it was a disaster.
Oh, yeah.
Because you had a mixture of local and confused tourist traffic going through there. And they didn't really take into account who was going through there. And they had to pull it out because you had people just, they had yield signs. People just drive right on through there and hit other cars. You know, and because a lot of the people there were, you know, one time go in and use it and never go back again. And they didn't learn or know about it. I was in there and had a guy, you know, almost crash into me and start yelling at me. You know, and because he didn't realize that he had to yield as he went into it. And it's just weird, you know, thing. But it is, you can, as you build these worlds, you can, you know, find out, you know, more experience about that.
So what do they say about this world that they're creating?
I mean, they just get into designing, talking about the collaboration for it. And they built it up into different districts. And it was just a way to see about, you know, people could brainstorm things about politics, economy, culture. And you can, one, you can realize the complexity of building something like this, but you can sometimes then learn how things work. And they talk about, you know, what each sort of person took from it. And I think there was a psychologist there who talked about, you know, what kind of environments make people more relaxed. It's a great way to test, let's say, economic theories and stuff, if you build a really efficient system from that. And as we get into more and more building virtual worlds outside of just gaming, that's a wonderful way to do predictive things.
Yeah, and there's been a number of examples. You know, somebody might be listening and say, I don't get it, it's just a video game or whatever. It may be a video game, but it's modeling very real human behavior and human responses to different types of very real designs. This is a very cheap way to prototype ideas that can mean a whole lot if you're building a city on a completely blank canvas, like, I don't know, Mars or something. Seems like there's some good intel that you'd get here.
Well, and you know, this is something that we saw on a small level with Second Life back in the early aughts, when that was very, very hot, there were, you know, I think the most interesting things that came out of it when it was at its most popular were people looking at cultural and economic trends that were real data. You know, it was real people making real decisions inside a virtual world that I think, you know, would be far shallower than, let's say, something that was as immersive as what we are looking at here. But the desire for that and the real-time application of that data is very much something that I think we've all been on the hunt for years.
You know, part of the reason, and I guess I need to finally get around to reading Chris Weil's book, because I assume this is why we're hitting the singularity, is that the number of iterations that we're able to get with the creation of these online worlds, where all of a sudden you have this throng of people go in, you have all these interactions, and then you can make after the fact case studies where you could take away important socioeconomic lessons. Like what was the story? It must have been like almost 10 years ago that there was some plot that had a disease, and then you could take the disease and infect other people in World of Warcraft. And counterintuitively, once people had it, they're all like, well, screw it. If I have it, you have to have it too. And then just a pandemic of it just swept over the entire game. These counterintuitive antisocial behaviors that are emergent from base sets of rules that all, as a guy who loves the Freakonomics podcast, this stuff fascinates me.
Mm-hmm. And you start to build better and better and better tools where you can then test things out. You know, you can have a very simple system if you want to play with economics and you can think something's going to work one way. The more complex it is, the more likely you are to find those counterintuitive things, those perverse incentives and stuff that we don't address or, you know, don't fit into the simple equations. And the better it gets, the more you see these things that become apparent. And that was one of the things that was interesting. Remember, when they started doing things like, I remember when they were shooting the Lord of the Rings movies and they built a software platform, I think it was called Horde or something like this, and it was for having thousands of orcs, you know, going to war, and how could you shoot these things in a computer without having to have animators program the path of every single one? And they put some very simple crowd behaviors in them, but then they say start the battle, some of them ran away, you know, yeah. Some of them did other things, and it was just that they had their own sort of slightly emergent behaviors.
Yeah, it was the corrupted blood incident is what I was thinking of in 2005. Look at that. I was right. It was about 10 years ago.
Yeah. Remember the and then you had back with was it Ultima Online when they killed Lord British?
Yeah. That was pretty amazing. There's like some kind of server reset and it forgot to make him immortal again. So somebody cast a wall of flame and Lord British just, you know, like, nice going, guys, steps into the flame and then dies. And then everybody just freaks the hell out. They're like, Lord British is dead. What?
Didn't anyone like where it was like they put a bomb that they knew where he was going to appear and they had a bomb set up that. So it was already set to go, so he teleported into the game at that point and the bomb blew up or something?
I don't know. I'm sure somebody will get us a relevant article. Killed in Ultima Online.
I mean, that's, you know, here's the guy, we know Richard, he's a brilliant guy. Here's the guy that made the game, and then people, I guess part of it's not just the fact that that technically they found a way around it. It's that sense of betrayal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it says here, the Wikipedia article says, Lord British was killed during an in-game appearance on Ultima Online's beta test on August 8th, 1997. A royal visit was conducted. A player character known as Reigns cast a spell, Firefield, on Lord British that surprisingly killed him. According to Star Long, the whole thing was just human error. Lord British's character, like others, had been made invulnerable, but by design, the invulnerability did not persist over several game sessions. Shortly before the incident, the server had crashed. Richard Garriott had forgotten to set his invulnerability flag when logging on again. Shortly afterwards, Reigns' account was banned from the beta test. For previously exploiting bugs rather than reporting them. That's amazing. That's the other thing. The entire function of griefing and how society, how anonymous is healthy anonymous, how anonymous is I'm free to speak my mind and engage, but not so anonymous that I could just lob hate bombs and then just go peeling out and not have to stick around and deal with any of the aftermath.
I mean, is that kind of like the defining conversation we can have about free speech in our modern age, right? Like the idea of anonymity being louder than it ever has been, and how awesome and terrible it can be simultaneously.
Well, I think the internet has figured out that we don't care if you're using your real name. We don't care how you represent yourself. We don't care even what you say. Just know that we will listen to what you say to the degree to which you have an established reputation beforehand. You know what I mean? Like a burner account just coming in and saying something, you know, will be judged on its own merits and may not, kind of like the way Reddit handles it, I think is a smart way to do it.
Have you read these other, all the other assassination attempts?
No. No. In Ultima 4, Quest of the Avatar, a player could cast a spell to create a lava field that damaged Lord British slightly. With enough patience and shuffling back and forth, Lord British could be killed. That's amazing.
There is a in a False Prophet. You could kill him by if a player dragged a poison trap to the British throne and detonate. That's what I think I was thinking of. He poisoned slowly, lost his health. They have another one where you can make a plaque fall on his head.
Oh wow,
dude, Lord British, like the Rasputin of his modern age.
And who has been to space, by the way?
Yeah. Wow.
Dude, Rasputin didn't do that.
Nope. That's funny.
That's awesome. Funny. Do we have time for another thing before we go into picks?
Absolutely.
Okay, I don't know what it is. I just
you don't know what it is.
I just knew that I'm out of commentary juice on world building.
All right, let me pull up
Although I will take this moment to give a shout out to that traffic book. It's a little bit dated in that there's much less of an emphasis on self-driving cars than I think there deserves to be nowadays. But it's Traffic. Why We Drive the Way We Drive, I think, is the Traffic. Why We Drive the Way We Do and what it says about us. Available on Amazon. In fact, I'll make that a preemptive pick. Do you just want to get into picks?
Yeah, we just get into picks.
Okay, it's by Tom Vanderbilt. It's good. Here we go, 2009. So yeah, it's about 5 years old. Before it was back when we were really excited about, you know, Stanley could just barely finish the DARPA challenge, and you know, self-driving cars really were, a far distant horizon idea in most people's minds at that time. But nowadays, it's like, I mean, I am seriously questioning whether or not I'll ever need to teach my daughter to drive, because by the time she drives, a fully autonomous self-driving car will be available.
Keep wishing, Brian.
What? Yeah. So the other thing I want to plug real quick is I did an hour-long interview on the successful performer cast with Ken Shepard, Chris Shepard. I'm sorry, Chris. There's another guy named Ken Shepard. Chris Shepard, K-R-I-S Shepard, K-R-I-S-S-H-E-P-P-A-R-D. And it's, there we go. If you look, go to successful performer cast, and it's like an hour long inside the actor's studio that he does. And yeah, let's see. Yep, there we go. And it just got posted. If you go to successfulperformercast.com/schwood, you can take a listen, and I recommend you guys check that out.
Awesome. Very cool.
Andrew?
My pick is... So, after listening to the fantastic and awesome Chris Taylor book, How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, I wanted to get into something else. And I figured I'm not going to jump into something else Star Wars, but let me find some other kind of book that'll get me engaged and cover something I'm interested in. I picked up the Jim Henson, the biography by Brian J. Jones. And at the start of it, it was really hard for me to get into it at first because, in my opinion, Jones committed two sins. The first one of a biography is the really, really lengthy going into who the parents were and who the grandparents were. And so when this started off with Civil War ancestors of Jim Henson,
oh, wow.
I'm like, running, you know, this is like puppets. The Bible. It's like, and so-and-so begat so-and-so, which has nothing to do with the story, but I'm going to tell you because there. That like had me kind of like on edge, because I'm like, I'm listening to this go on and on and on about this before Jim Henson's even born, right? And I would argue, like, in like the Walt Disney biography, they do that, but also this is a guy born at the turn of the century. This is a guy that, like, he is so much a bridge between kind of 19th century and 20th century values, in a sense that it was kind of his father working in the World's Fair was important and stuff, but all that. But even then, that was felt a lot. But anyhow,
saying that Jim Henson's great great granddaddy didn't like solve the Civil War with a puppet show, and therefore
it is not
legitimate toward this in this biography for the body of work.
Then it starts off with, and you know, Jim wanted a television, and then the next chapter is Philo T. Farnsworth. You know, it was an unlikely da 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 da. I'm like, you're giving me the history of the invention of the television. And, like, I'm about ready to go, like, delete, ask for my money back, get another book. Because I'm like, this is just starting way too slow for me. Way, 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 way too slow.
Right.
And I was literally on Audible, about ready to say, you know what, this is not for me. I can't handle this. I can't handle this. But then I had a drive where I had something, you know what, let me just persevere. And once we got past that and it started getting into it, I realized this is the most in-depth biography of Jim Henson I could have hoped for.
Oh, really?
And it's actually quite fantastic. And I didn't go too much into the history of Philo T. Farnsworth and the invention of television, because, you know, it was also, it's like, well, that's a very short version of the story, what happened there. Not quite fully the full short version. But anyhow, I'm loving it now. I'm like 3 hours into it, 4 hours into it. It is very, very thorough. In the book that I recommended before about, you know, the business book that was based on
Henson's
life, I kind of lost, like, about halfway into it, it just sort of felt like it was just kind of going on, where we'll see where this goes. But I mean, this is telling the story of Jim Henson in tons of details I'd never heard before, things I didn't know about, and a really, really, really good insight into the man. So I am now strongly recommending Jim Henson, the biography.
I did finish Make Art Make Money, and I liked it a lot. You know, maybe it was just the right time for me to hear those lessons, but those definitely resonated.
I think I highly recommend Make Art Make Money, but, you know, like any other business book like that, be prepared for them, you know, taking what would be
less telling the story of Jim Henson and more telling the takeaways you should learn from the story of Jim Henson.
Yeah. But it's still great. It's absolutely great. I recommend that. I recommend them both.
So listen, guys, I'm going to really blow your minds with my pick this week.
What?
I've been reading this book, How Star Wars Conquered the Universe. All right? And I want to just enlighten you guys on how awesome this book is. I'm tired of you guys ignoring it. I really feel it's time to shine a light on this fine work of nonfiction. All right. So everything that has been said on this podcast about this book, absolutely true, 110%. It is from somebody who wrote news articles. It is a great, I think Andrew touched on how awesome it is that it is not just an analysis of the work. It is something for which, you know, research is at the forefront and not analysis, which I think is with something that has been analyzed as much as Star Wars kind of necessary. Though where I'm at in the story now is as the prequels are getting made, and what I just heard is the narrative of the collective that waited outside the canonical theater ran the first Star Wars back in 77. And they were all excited because it was episode one. It's 1999. And everybody gathered in front of there and became, in many ways, you know, what for me wasn't only just as it is painted in this book, this sign of resurgent Star Wars fandom, but really to me is just like the DNA of kind of our modern con culture. really. This idea that, you know, it's the people you know. You know, there's this great line where a guy moves from somewhere in the East Coast to San Francisco so he can go see episode one at the theater that Star Wars A New Hope was initially screened at in 77, and tells his boss at his new job fixing ATMs, hey, great, I'm glad that I have this job. Thank you for letting me pay my rent. Also, I need most of April and half of May off. And that's for whatever the deal is. That's what I just that needs to happen, or else I'm quitting right now because I need to go wait in line for Star Wars. And the boss says, all right, laughs a bunch, and then says, well, can you get me a ticket too if you're waiting in line? And that, to me, is so much what we see whenever we go to Dragon Con every year. And the costumes get more pervasive, the attendances just get larger and larger, and you are seeing this mainstream element of let's gather together and mingle on this art. And that obviously had gone on for years before. The idea of cons, is something that is not necessarily new, but it not being stigmatized is something that I feel has continued to erode since 1999 to where we are now, to the point where, listen, I'm a guy is about to get married at Dragon Con, and the amount of people that I have told, and
breaking for the Weird Things audience, people, Justin's going to get married at Dragon Con,
and you're invited.
Yeah. Like it is not. I've gotten far more that's rads than the scancy pants, like, oh, geez, really, nerd? Like, or even just uncomfortable silences that I was expecting. You know, it is, and for whatever reason, it's like my friends, my family that are not really into this kind of stuff, they are excited for it and seem to be excited to have a reason to go experience stuff like this because they're into the art. They're just not necessarily had a reason to go to the event. And that's kind of what I've taken from that book and its excellent reporting on the hysteria surrounding episode one. Now we can skip exactly what happened after the
have you got to the part when they're waiting in line at that theater and they're doing a preview screening and Francis Ford Coppola is
yes.
there?
Yes, amazing.
Wait, I am not remembering it. This is the prequel or the original?
The prequels.
Oh no!
So they're waiting in line,
yeah.
Right? And at that same theater that they want to go see because it's important to them in Star Wars lore. It's of course it's important to Lucas. So Lucas holds the big VIP screening there.
Right.
And two interesting things happen. Number one, you have this devil's bargain because the Lucasfilm people, which are well aware of this camp out of everybody, says
and super supportive.
Super supportive. Rick McCallum, the producer, comes out and is super down with them. The Lucasfilm representative comes out to the organizers there and says, okay, there are like 5 seats left. Whoever wants to come in can come in. And so now the group has this, like, wait a minute, we waited together, like, and they declare, hey, listen, whoever goes in now, you're forfeiting your tickets on opening day.
You're spacing the line. You don't get to be at the group anymore.
Yeah, so it's like, you can go see it if you want, but just know that you can't give it, you're giving up your spot with us, which is an amazing drama. But then everyone's in. And a few people trickle in to go see and break off from the group just because the pull of it is too much. Francis Ford Coppola comes out of the theater while it's still going and starts smoking a cigar.
Oh, that's right. I do remember that.
Somebody tries to take a a picture with them and Francis Ford Coppola behind him. And Coppola slaps the camera out of his hand and says, hey, listen, if you want a picture, come take a picture with me. It's really cool to everybody. And, they're like, so why aren't you in there? Why aren't you watching the movie? And he very politically says, I've seen parts of it before. Which pretty much tells you everything you need to know about episode
I
one.
Just, I just love that part is telling, but I love, like, you know, he's there and they're secretly taking photos of him.
Yeah.
And he yells at him.
Yeah, calls him out. Yeah.
Yeah, come on over here if you want a photo.
Yeah. The creation of the 501st as well is a really inspiring story, where it's like the dawning realization that being one stormtrooper makes you a dork. Two stormtroopers makes you kind of cool. Being a legion of stormtroopers, pretty much the raddest thing on the planet.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, listen, we can rant and rave about this book, and it deserves all of it, because it's, you know, you would not guess that it took until 2014 to write the definitive book about Star Wars and Star Wars culture. But
now that you're far enough along with it, and of course we've spent hours by now praising this book, do we want to try to get in an interview with the author?
Yeah, we can do that.
No reason not to.
Yeah.
My only hesitation would be that I'd be afraid of wasting his time and asking stupid questions. I'm speaking for myself.
My guess is he would like that. We could do that as another special for patrons.
He's at Future Boy on Twitter.
At Future Boy.
Twitter. So when George Lucas was making Star Wars, did he think it was awesome, or did he think it was really awesome?
Did you see the SNL parody of the Star Wars Force Awakens trailer?
No, I did not. Was it good?
They did a parody of the new Star Wars
trailer. Right. Well, was it good?
So what they did is they had the actors from SNL do a parody of the Force Awakens trailer, because they have a history of doing, like, parodies and stuff.
Right. But was it good? Was it entertaining? Did you laugh?
So what they did is they took Star Wars and the fact that there's excitement over this new trailer, and they made their own trailer about it.
Right on.
It's got one joke. The older cast members are old.
Got it. Well, I'll check that out as soon as we're.
I will say the impressions. I did like I like the impressions. I wish that there was more kind of meat to.
Yeah,
to
like point out, like, Salacious Crumb in a wheelchair was actually hilarious. Chewbacca with a collar, radar collar, was kind of a fun
dog
visual
collar. Pair.
Yeah,
it's hard to do anything like that without Spaceballs sort of kind of being like. I just was like, all right, I hope they go in a lot of directions with this. Nope. It's just the fact that the old original cast is old now. It's like, all right. Yeah, we know that.
Which is kind of funny because, that trailer was pretty deliberately about everything but the
old characters. Cast. Yeah.
Yeah.
In fact, I was absolutely thrilled to not see R2-D2. I'm so sick of being sold on R2-D2. Yes, he's adorable. Yes, he's in every movie. Yes, he's more competent than you give him credit for. Yes, he's the only one who hasn't had his... I'm done. I'm done with those two droids. They're played out.
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to see them in the next ones, but I don't need it to be, Yeah, I mean, I will say that the prequels gave us some details that were kind of interesting in a sense, like, how did an astromech really work?
Yeah,
and it was kind of neat, But
all right, are we wrapping this up?
We're wrapping this up, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for tuning in. Next week, Let me check my flight times here, because I've got to fly out to go see the SpaceX launch. And I have, what's my...
What is it, what are they shooting off this week?
Next, it'll be Tuesday. They're shooting the Falcon to the International Space Station and trying to land the first stage on a barge.
Oh, that's huge!
It'll happen at 2:30 in the afternoon Eastern time. So I fly out Sunday at 3:00. So we'll have to figure out if we do this earlier or whatever. But
yeah. Cool.
Anyhow. But we'll totally want to do a Tuesday cast earlier. It'll be earlier in the day, and there you go. So
we're gonna if it lands on the barge, we're gonna play the barge. We're gonna play Rhythm of the Night.
Done it, done. Licensing be damned. Time to celebrate.
It's been weird.
All right. Boop, 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 boop. Save and copy as. Here, I'll. Can somebody give me a link to that Saturday Night Live thing? I'll watch it, and you can watch me watching it. All right, what are we calling this one?
Let's call this something Orion.
What's that line from the Tears and Rain speech?
Oh yeah, I've seen sea beams glittering in the night off the shoulders of Orion.
All right, can we say on the shoulders of Orion?
Oh, let's see. Yeah, let's see. See, you know, and you know who wrote that?
Yeah, Rutger Hauer did. Howard, yeah, Hauer. Yeah, because the original thing was just nonsense. It was just a litany of too many things. And
attack
that,
ships.
Attack ships?
Yeah, attack ships on fire off the shoulder of Orion. I watched sea beams glitter in the dark near the Tannhauser Gate. Which I thought was just amazingly poetic, which made that universe feel so big.
Yeah. I'll just call it Off the Shoulder of Orion, if that works.
Yeah, works for me. All right. Great suggestion.
And really, like, just amazing work for the mythos of, like, crazy-ass Rutger Hauer, right?
Yeah.
Like, that there's, like, that's just swimming around in Rutger Hauer's brain. It's just awesome.
Yeah. All right, looks like I'm going to have to wait two more seconds, and then I get to see.
There is an alliance of heroes.
I can get away with playing this, right? On the stream.
And the old.
Boy, it really is. Just that one joke.
Falcon. I need to find Luke Skywalker. I need to find Luke Skywalker.
All right. Wait, what?
Can you help me find Luke Skywalker?
Hold on. I'll take the early bird special.
And I'm in the menu. I don't want the menu. I want to record.
Hey, Han, how do you work this friggin' thing?
Luke.
Wow, listen to the tepid Luke. Response.
There's a disturbance in the force. I must go.
Shouldn't have to do no damn chores.
What?
Nothing.
Damn right.
That's pretty much straight rip from The Incredibles, right?
Yeah. Yep.
What the f*** was that?
I have a thyroid issue, like my father before me.
Jesus. man, why is Hulu out here straight lying to deaf people with that applause or laughter?
Have you seen the Disney one? Like the let me see if I here's the thing. Like there, I haven't watched this one yet. But there have been some other, like the ones where it was like, you know, the George Lucas fixes the special edition of the
Oh, dude, that one was amazing because it made every single edit made a specific point about something that was in the.
And I don't want people thinking like, oh, they're messing with our favorite thing. You're like, no, we love like good parody. It's just like, yeah, it's like, wow, is that that's like the fan stuff is better than the people who got paid to make this thing.
Oh, man, there has been an awakening. I really don't like the way new Have Skype handles it? Messages. Yeah, I don't know. I think I'm over the whole Disney owns the thing, so now it's going to be all Disney-fied thing. Because like,
I hear you. I think it's funny the way that they tried to throw all the Disney Dumbos instead of TIE Fighters and stuff is kind of clever.
Yeah,
I'm a sucker for a sound punchline. That's that was what I like. Just a random like hook. Like I don't know. But I think it's amazing to see just how far that's exploded, as long as it was, and that all the parodies are like, oh, here's a different version of it that are really like, I mean, you saw like the Wes Anderson one that blew up this week. It's making fun of Wes Anderson, not the trailer, you know, like I think that's its own sign that like, you know, the George Lucas one is making fun of the special editions and using Star Wars as the blunt object, or that trailer as the blunt object to do it, is really interesting that it's not just like, oh, let's crap on this trailer or let's point out things that are dumb about the trailer.
Right.
Yeah, it's a really good analysis because I think that's like with the SNL one, it's like, hey, they're old now. Yeah. That's a thing that happened.
they are.
And it's a trailer that didn't try to sell us on watch these old people. It was watch. Here's a new generation. You know, so that's the thing.
It's like it would have been funnier if they were in the trailer. You know, if there was like if it was there, then you could do. And I don't know. Like there are parts of that I think are funny. I think I would like to see more of Bobby Moynihan as old Carrie Fisher, because I think that there's like Carrie Fisher has such a bombastic kind of personality that I think Bobby Moynihan could do a good job with. And I'm sure if he's still on the cast when it comes out, that'll be something that we see or in the further trailers. But at the same time, just Christ, old people can't use a VCR? Like, really? That's where we're at? Like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. I'm uploading.
And by the way, if you don't frequent the StarWars.com blog, you should think about it.
Oh, yeah? Why?
It's about Star Wars.
Oh.
They're launching a new comic line called new Star Wars comic line, by the way, with the original characters.
Oh, right on. That's cool. All right, guys. I gotta run and do dad stuff. But people are asking, yeah, dude, I'm watching the hell out of Black Mirror. That's on Netflix now. First time legally available in the U.S. Holy crap, guys.
What is it?
Black Mirror. Nobody say nothing in the chat. Don't give them any preconceived notions. Just go in cold if you can. It's an anthology series. Think Twilight Zone for the digital age. It's the Black Mirror it's referring to is your phone. And it's awesome.
Nice. How long is it?
They're like 45 minutes each. For 50 minutes, maybe? They're each individual story, but they're exquisitely told and each completely independent. It's awesome.
Rad ass.
My fear of something like this is either one, I'll be like, man, or I'll be like, oh, it's so good. I wish I did this.
That's how I feel watching other magicians perform. Like, if I love their act, I'm like, damn, I can't ever do that because he's doing that. And if I hate it, I'm like, damn, did I waste my time watching a bad magic act?
Well, you certainly have both opened yourself up to the true joy of the universe, folks.
We're small, small, small men, Justin.
All right, guys, I'm going to shut down the stream shortly.
Oh, question. Go Home Santa.
Oh, yeah. When is it updated and out?
I just got the audiobook for the final two chapters back today. So I'll review them. And if everything's up to par, then it'll go live tonight. The ebook is available now. So you can get the ebook on Amazon or gohomesanta.com. But don't buy the audiobook if you want the new stuff until I tell you, which will be.